Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Midway Submerged, American and Japanese Submarine Operations at the Battle of Midway, May through June, 1942, by Mark W. Allen, narrated by Stephen Bowlby. Publisher's note: this audiobook contains references to material present in the print and ebook editions of the book. It was to the submarine force that I looked to carry the load until our great industrial activity could produce the weapons we so sorely needed to carry the war to the enemy. It is to the everlasting honor and glory of our submarine personnel that they never failed us in our days of great peril. Chester W. Nimitz, Fleet Admiral, U.S. Navy. Foreword in United States Submarine Operations in World War II. By Theodore Roscoe, PV, 1949. Foreword. The Battle of Midway in June 1942 is rightly considered one of the most important naval battles in history, and perhaps the pivotal naval battle of World War II in the Pacific. It is certainly one of the best-known battles of the Pacific War and the most written-about naval battle of the war. The broad outlines of the battle are familiar to anyone with even a passing acquaintance with the history of World War II. How the armed forces of Imperial Japan, beginning with a crushingly successful surprise attack on the Hawaiian Islands, swept all before them in a stunning campaign of conquest in the Western Pacific. So successful was this naval blitzkrieg that the Japanese achieved all their pre-war territorial goals faster than their most optimistic estimates had forecast. By the spring of 1942, they had, while sustaining only minimal casualties, essentially completed their conquest of the greater East Asian co-prosperity sphere. This produced significant debate within the Japanese high command as to the nature and target of their next major offensive. That there would be another major offensive was accepted by the high command without question. What the Japanese would later term victory disease, a belief the Japanese military could accomplish any goal it set for itself with minimal losses, had already become the standard mindset in the Japanese military. Various options were considered for the next Japanese victory, such as operations against British India, either overland through Burma or by sea against Ceylon or eastern India. Efforts to isolate and perhaps invade Australia, or a drive to the east to engage and destroy the remnants of the U.S. Pacific Fleet that had escaped destruction at Pearl Harbor, most notably the American aircraft carriers, coupled with a possible occupation of the Hawaiian Islands. This last option had the powerful support of Admiral Yamamoto Isoroku, the architect of the Pearl Harbor attack, and his support ultimately carried the debate, although a limited move against Australia in the form of an amphibious assault against Port Moresby in New Guinea was also approved, as was an operation to occupy several of the Aleutian Islands in the far northern Pacific. The operation to destroy the U.S. fleet would take the form of a massive naval attack to occupy the tiny base on Midway Island to the northwest of the Hawaiian Islands. This attack on and occupation of Midway would, so the plan went, force the U.S. Navy to respond, and, in so doing, the Japanese forces of Kido Butai, Mobile Force, the innovative Japanese Naval Task Force comprised of their fleet aircraft carriers, would then locate and destroy the American carriers as they sailed to engage the Japanese fleet, leaving the Japanese with complete dominance throughout the Pacific. The major events of the campaign are well known. How U.S. naval intelligence had been able to break Imperial Japanese naval radio codes and was able to provide enough advance intelligence to allow Admiral Nimitz, the U.S. naval commander in the Pacific, to know the target of the Japanese operation in advance. This information enabled the Americans to plan to ambush the Japanese naval forces by pre-positioning all of their available carriers to the north and east of Midway, and operating with the support of land-based air power on Midway itself. The advantage of surprise would, in theory, helped to offset the Japanese advantage of numbers and concentration of force. The initial stages of the battle appeared to signal yet another impressive Japanese victory, as Japanese air power swept the American planes from the skies, and they appeared to be on the verge of occupying Midway and fending off American airstrikes, and eventually finishing off the American carriers, just as Yamamoto had hoped to do. Yet in one of the most stunning reversals of fortune of the entire war, in a matter of moments, American Dauntless dive bombers from the USS Enterprise and USS Yorktown arrived essentially simultaneously over the Japanese fleet, and, unmolested by Japanese fighters or anti-aircraft fire, proceeded to obtain direct hits on three of the four Japanese fleet carriers. These ships, due to hectic combat operations, were strewn with poorly stored bombs and torpedoes, as well as quantities of aviation gasoline as refueling operations were underway. The American bomb hits ignited raging infernos, which Japanese damage control and firefighting measures were inadequate to control. In a matter of minutes, three Japanese aircraft carriers were reduced to flaming wrecks, and although the fourth carrier, Hiryu, survived long enough to launch a crippling strike on Yorktown, it too succumbed to American air power a short time later. The Japanese lost all four of their fleet carriers that had engaged in this battle, as well as a heavy cruiser. American losses were limited to Yorktown and a destroyer that had been assisting in the efforts to recover the carrier. The results of this battle indeed altered the nature of the war in the Pacific, although not in the fashion envisioned by Admiral Yamamoto. Almost exactly 6 months after the attack on Pearl Harbor, the Japanese Navy was deprived of its primary striking power and would never again engage in a major offensive operation. All of this is well known, and rightfully so. But this information is not the entire story of the battle. There is another aspect of the battle that also deserves to be known. While air power bore the brunt of the combat, there was another element of naval power on both sides that was one of the few elements of either fleet to actually see combat during the battle. This hidden element of the Battle of Midway is, appropriately, the submarine forces of both the Japanese and American navies. Mark Allen has produced a comprehensive examination of this little-known aspect of this pivotal naval battle. This project originated as a master's thesis, which I had the privilege of supervising. Delving deeply into the archives, Mark has studied not just the battle itself, but submarine design and construction, as well as tactical and operational doctrine for both the United States and Japan. He has also examined the intended role of the submarine in the plans and doctrine of both navies, and what the submarines were supposed to accomplish for both fleets during the battle. From this foundation, he has examined the actual accomplishments, successes, and failures of the submarine service of both the Japanese and American navies. Of particular importance, he has also analyzed how well these vessels fulfilled the expectations placed on them by their respective naval planners. Submarines turned out to be far more important to the outcome of the battle than has been previously understood. I believe this work enhances the understanding of one of the most pivotal battles of the 20th century. A complete account of the Battle of Midway requires a study of the role of the silent service in its outcome, and Mark's book provides that. Thomas J. Goetz, Professor of Military History, American Military University, Charlestown, West Virginia, May 25, 2011. Preface. Most literature examining the Battle of Midway usually focuses on American and Japanese carrier operations. Intertwined are discussions of naval aviation, the sinking of four Japanese carriers and one American carrier, the chess match between Admirals Chester W. Nimitz and Yamamoto Isoroku, and what some have called the turning point of the war in the Pacific. These discussions do not normally examine detailed submarine operations during the battle. Any reference to submarines usually criticizes their lack of involvement and operational mismanagement. This reevaluation of the Battle of Midway presents an in-depth look at Japanese and American submarine operations before, during, and after the battle. Initially, my argument was to focus on the deployment of submarines by both Japan and the United States. I would show how both sides misused their submarines, which, for Japan, contributed to defeat. Two Japanese submarine cordons were late getting on station, allowing American forces to position themselves northeast of Midway, unseen. Therefore, Japanese naval leaders were unaware there were American carriers in the area. I would next point out how Admiral Nimitz incorrectly placed his submarines in an arc west of Midway, when he knew, based on information from his codebreakers, where the Japanese striking force would appear. I figured both statements would be easy concepts to prove. The only thing I proved was that going into a project with preconceived ideas was a dangerous thing to do. It is easy to play Monday morning quarterback years after an event and with significantly more information than was available at the time. This was the course I started down, reading secondary sources that made statements I accepted as fact, assuming previous authors based their research on primary sources. It was only when I dug deeper into primary sources myself that I realized my initial preconceived ideas were not quite correct. I therefore started from scratch, researching both Japanese and American naval doctrine and how that related to submarine strategy and tactics. I next reviewed operational orders for both sides, evaluating Yamamoto's attack-invasion plan and how Nimitz planned to counter it. Then it was a matter of tracking submarine activity throughout the battle, relying heavily on the patrol reports and after-action reports by both Admirals Nimitz and Robert H. English. It was at this point that I realized Nimitz did not plan to use the submarines of Task Group 7 offensively. He and English deployed them in defensive sectors against the anticipated Japanese occupation force. In most instances, information on the Battle of Midway is so focused on carrier actions and naval aviation that the fact the Japanese were sailing a force to occupy Midway gets lost. However, Nimitz was keenly aware of this fact. He employed the assets he had and used them in their proper role at the time, to stop the invasion. This was not the popular move. Just ask English, Commander Submarines Pacific, who wanted to vector the submarines towards the Japanese striking force and attack the carriers. Moreover, it is not the popular move according to many historians and authors years after the event. Additionally, research into the Japanese side of the battle indicates there was more to the fiasco with the late arrival of their submarines than I initially thought. The problem was not so much the late arrival on station, as it was a faulty strategic and tactical plan by Admiral Yamamoto and the strict adherence to this plan by his admirals. Nimitz has taken a lot of criticism over the years due to what some think was an improper use of his submarines at the Battle of Midway. Most authors and historians suggest he should have sent the submarines to attack the Japanese striking force. But then the question is, how would you propose to defend against the Japanese invasion? In terms of submarine deployment at Midway, Nimitz got it right. And this book tells the story. In hindsight, I greatly admire Admiral Nimitz. His tactical genius has humbled me. I grew up not far from the World War II fleet submarine USS Batfish, SS-310. This cool place to visit turned into fascination and then admiration. Since then, I have grown increasingly interested in the silent service during World War II. The concept for this book originated from my master's thesis at American Military University. Before I started graduate school, I knew I wanted to write my thesis on some type of submarine warfare in the Pacific Theater, something significant that had not been written about in detail. I settled on submarine actions at the Battle of Midway because, as previously mentioned, most texts focus on the carrier aspect of the battle. Mark W. Allen, Owosso, Oklahoma, July 29, 2022. Chapter 1, Introduction. Midway was the decisive battle. The Battle of Midway is one of the most analyzed battles of World War II's Pacific Theater. Most studies focus on Japanese versus American carrier operations, as naval air power ultimately decided the battle's outcome. Japan's operational objectives at Midway were clear. The first objective focused on the invasion and capture of the island itself. The second objective was to draw out the American Pacific Fleet to engage and destroy it in a decisive battle. Once the 3,500-strong occupation force secured Midway, Japanese naval forces would reposition themselves around the island to intercept and destroy the U.S. fleet Admiral Yamamoto Isoroku anticipated would sail in defense of Midway. In total, Japanese forces included 11 battleships and 4 carriers, as well as assorted cruisers and destroyer squadrons, troop ships, and supply ships. 3 American carriers and aircraft stationed on Midway oppose Japan's carrier armada. Many authors have described the battle both from the Japanese and American perspectives, and how, in a matter of minutes, American dive bombers destroyed 3 Japanese carriers and sank a 4th later that same day. In comparison, the American Pacific Fleet lost only 1 carrier. Some claim Midway was an intelligence victory. The United States capitalized on it, while the Japanese ignored it. Others state luck played a big part. However, they all agree that naval air power won the battle. What authors have not focused on in any detail are Japanese and American submarine operations before, during, and after the battle. Most authors criticize Admiral Chester Nimitz, claiming he should have placed his submarines farther away from Midway to strike at Japan's carriers before they could launch airstrikes against the island. However, Nimitz assigned American submarines to defensive roles, acting as a strike force against an anticipated Japanese amphibious assault on Midway, leaving only American carrier aircraft to strike at Japan's carriers. It was a matter of mobility and defense, and Nimitz correctly assigned his available assets to their proper role. Literature that addresses submarine operations at Midway mostly focuses on their failure and operational mismanagement. Most authors and some Japanese military leaders claim the late arrival of one of the Japanese submarine scouting lines significantly contributed to Japan's defeat. For example, among the several factors that contributed to the Japanese disaster at Midway, the failure of Subron 5 took high place, or this delay in stationing submarines is considered to be a major flaw in the Japanese plan. From the American perspective, authors almost exclusively claim Nimitz and Admiral Robert English deployed American submarines too close to Midway, which prevented their offensive deployment against Japan's carrier striking force. Some examples include: whoever created the submarine plan, it was bad. Most of the submarines were disposed for a concentrated defense close into Midway, instead of being offensively placed farther out, where they may have had an opportunity to torpedo a Japanese carrier before the decisive battle. U.S. submarines had been poorly deployed to intercept the Japanese fleet attacking Midway. They were too close to the island. They needed to be much farther away to spot, report, and attack the Japanese carriers heading for Midway. The placement of submarines at Midway and poor command and control by the sink and comm subpack precluded their massing to attack in concert with Midway-based and carrier-based aircraft. Better placement of the arcs further out would have reduced submarine transit time, as well as allowed the submarines to attack and disrupt the force before the arrival of U.S. aircraft. Normally, discussions concerning American and Japanese submarines center around these topics, and only in generalities, claiming both sides failed to use their submarines correctly and successfully. To understand failure or success of Japanese and American submarines at Midway, we must understand the following relationship: doctrine, then strategy, then tactics, then deployment. In essence, this states that tactics define submarine deployment. tactics are a byproduct of strategy, and strategy develops from naval doctrine. Leaders of the interwar maritime countries not only believed in battleship supremacy, but also shared a philosophy about the role of sea power in national defense. They all subscribed to the tenets of Mahanian doctrine. In his 1941 book, Armed Forces of the Pacific, W.D. Pewelston, a captain in the U.S. Navy and head of the Office of Naval Intelligence, compared the military power of the United States and Japan and arrived at certain conclusions based on doctrine and tactics of that time. Pewelston concluded operations of the two fleets would determine the outcome of a war between the two countries, operations that included submarines, naval aviation, and all available army aviation. Both fleets would endeavor to gain and exercise control of the Western Pacific to ensure its use to friendly ships and deny it to hostile ones. Pewelston suggested the quickest way to gain this control was to defeat the opposing fleet. Based on treaty limitations, the commander-in-chief of the U.S. fleet, which would be stronger, would attempt to bring the Japanese to action in the open sea. The commander-in-chief of the Japanese fleet would try to reduce American superiority by submarines, aviation, and minefields before accepting a daylight action in which he would risk defeat and possible annihilation. Japan would attempt a war of attrition as soon as hostilities commenced, and would take full advantage of its geographical position to wage it. Although Japan created its navy on a Western model, its operational methods remained essentially Oriental. Japanese leaders were aware of the Western doctrines of singularity of aim and concentration of force. They had failed to rid themselves, nonetheless, of ancient Asian notions of the value of complexity and diffusion. Yamamoto argued strongly to abandon the old naval strategy of interception operations and systematic reduction of the enemy fleet as it reached out to the Western Pacific. He advocated for more offensive operations, such as the invasion and occupation of the Hawaiian Islands. Admiral Yamamoto designed his Midway plan to confuse the enemy. He divided his fleet into five separate bodies, each committed to a different geographical objective or operational aim. Japanese plans required their submarines to patrol along scouting lines, or cordons, to hunt for and intercept American task forces. Japan's use of submarines in support of fleet operations was typical of their use at Midway. Yamamoto was confident the U.S. fleet would not be in the area prior to the initial attack on Midway, and he therefore did not emphasize reconnaissance in the early stages of the operation. He anticipated any major naval engagement with American forces would occur after Japanese occupation forces occupied Midway. Yamamoto's plan counted on the Americans sailing from Pearl Harbor in response to Japan's surprise attack on Midway, and, on arrival of the U.S. fleet, Japanese submarines and carriers would deliver the first attack. There was no contingency plan if American forces acted in a way Yamamoto did not expect. As previously stated, historians place significant blame for Japan's defeat at Midway on the late arrival of submarine scouting line Subron 5. The blame is rooted in Subron 5's failure to spot the American carriers, preventing Admiral Chuichi Nagumo's striking force from knowing enemy carriers were in the area. This would have put the American carriers as top priority instead of continuing the attack on Midway Island. American carriers were already northeast of Midway by June 1st and would have escaped detection even if Subron 5 had been on station at the designated time. Furthermore, the Japanese fleet was operating under the assumption American forces would not be in the vicinity of Midway until at least June 7th, sailing after the island's occupation. Based on Yamamoto's anticipated timeline, Japanese submarines, even though 2 days late, were still on station in plenty of time to intercept and attack any American ships racing to Midway in response to the Japanese invasion. The American and Japanese pre-war models of naval warfare were similar, with submarines being auxiliaries to the battle fleet. However, the Japanese attack at Pearl Harbor changed this role for the United States. With a battle fleet destroyed or damaged, submarines and aircraft carriers became the offensive striking force of the American Pacific Fleet. Submarines adopted the role of commerce raiders and targeted the supply line of Japan, mimicking the role German U-boats successfully used against Great Britain. However, when American naval intelligence discovered the Japanese plan to invade Midway, Nimitz needed all his fleet assets to defend the island. He therefore temporarily removed American submarines from their role as commerce raiders and placed them back into the fleet support role, not in defense of the fleet itself, but in defense of Midway against an anticipated Japanese amphibious assault. Many historians make statements like, 26 submarines were deployed by Nimitz, although in the course of the Battle of Midway, they proved largely ineffective, or the American submarines as a whole had performed poorly. Broad statements like these diminish the role American submarines played during the conflict and downgrade their accomplishments. Researchers should look at the previously mentioned statements and ask, why did submarines fail at Midway? Or why did submarines perform poorly at Midway? Is it true that American and Japanese submarines had little effect in the battle? The researcher will find answers to questions surrounding submarine failure, performance, and deployment in the answer to one additional question. What role did American and Japanese submarines perform at Midway? When analyzing submarine actions at the Battle of Midway, historians should consider three things. First, carrier operations and naval aviation overshadow the role submarines had at Midway. Second, there does not appear to be enough research into Admiral Ernest King's operational orders to Admiral Nimitz. Third, there is a timing misconception regarding when Japanese submarines were to be on station versus when American carriers were to sail in defense of Midway. The first statement is not a criticism of carrier naval aviation. It is a known fact that naval aviation won the battle. The problem regarding the submarine is that with a voluminous amount of research written about the battle, submarine actions, for the most part, are just footnotes in the overall history. Most texts briefly mention submarine actions, and in doing so, continue with a line of reasoning that submarines failed at Midway. As for the second statement, it appears most historians direct criticism of submarine deployment squarely at Nimitz and indirectly at English. In hindsight, these historians feel Nimitz should have used his submarines offensively, as Admiral English preferred. Nimitz overruled English and placed the submarines in defensive arcs west of Midway. Why did he do that? Researching that question should reduce much of the criticism. A complication from a literature standpoint is it seems that some authors quote past authors instead of reading the primary sources themselves and accept previous research as accurate. This type of reasoning contributes to the continued criticism directed at Nimitz and to the confusion surrounding submarine actions at Midway. As stated, most historians...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.